You're already mad at me, and we haven't even started. I think this is our least prepared episode ever. We've both been super busy today.
We have said that before with unprepared episodes, but this is really like, well, I guess we have a thing to do, and this is literally the only time we can do it. So we have to record right now, because you are going to be traveling and I am going to be traveling. So if we don't record today, it's not going to happen.
Potentially, we could both be on planes when people listen to this one.
Oh, yeah. Actually, I think I very well may be on an airplane when people are listening to this, or quite shortly thereafter.
Thereabouts.
I will be on a plane when this one airs.
The day we're recording this is the day that Gray's just put out his Scandinavia video.
4 hours ago is when I put it out.
And I think I put out 4 or 5 videos today. It's been mad, but it has been mad. So we are both. Well, I didn't edit and make all of them, mm-hmm. but I also uploaded some today that aren't released today. Can I just say, by the way, I've been meaning to bring this up for a while, and this is completely unnecessary to bring up, but I'm bringing it up.
We got nothing. Just go with it.
We got nothing. I know people get very excited about all these Brady versus Gray widgets and websites and spreadsheets and that, comparing how many videos I've made since you last made a video and how many views yours have had compared to mine and all that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Not only do I think that's completely pointless and like comparing apples with kiwi fruits, like in many ways,
right.
Not only is it pointless for those reasons, but it's also completely broken, because if one of us uploads... Well, I'm speaking more about me here. If I upload a bunch of videos and don't make them public for various reasons, because I'm staggering releases and things, when I then make them public, all these widgets and that use the date that I uploaded them, not the date they go public. So there's always some videos that aren't counted in the tally and all this sort of thing. So not only are the numbers pointless, but the numbers are wrong. Mm-hmm. And as I've said before, I think it's great that people do it and it's funny and cute, but... some people take it really seriously, and they probably shouldn't.
My understanding is that this, again, is, like many things, entirely YouTube's fault, because they don't actually have any place where you can access the published date. There is only the uploaded date. So there's no information for any of these things to draw from about when was the video actually made public. So, yes, I have run into this sometimes as well, where I have a... videos are uploaded in a different order from the time they actually go public, and it's just very frustrating. It's weird. It's yet another weird little thing that, like, why can't you have a published date? Who cares about the upload date? Nobody.
Is it more YouTube half assery?
It is more YouTube half assery. That's entirely true. Which can we jump right into a little follow up item, because this list goes right up against that.
You do it.
Or did you have something else? It sounded like...
No. It sounds like you've found yourself a little segue there. That's quite unusual, so I'm not going to ruin it for you.
Okay, well, we just have ruined the segue. But the very first thing that I have in follow-up is, I mentioned it last time, even still, more people have sent me all kinds of bizarre configurations about where the card little icon appears on various different devices. It's in all kinds of crazy locations. And since the last time we recorded, YouTube has moved the branding box that I was complaining about last time, where at least on the computer, the place for the card button and the place for the branding box were in the same location. And I thought, why on earth did you put the two of them there? You should have the branding box or the eye in different places. And they move the branding box to what seems to me one of the worst locations, which is now the bottom right-hand corner is where they put the little logo box on top of all of your videos. And it's like, oh, come on, guys. That seems like a terrible place to put it. I don't know why you decided that was the one to go for, but that's where they put it. And it is irritating to me, because... that is a place that is very useful in animate. Like, the bottom part of it is very useful for animations. And so now it's like yet another thing I have to be aware of when I'm putting together my slides of like, oh, right. Anything in the bottom right hand corner is going to be covered up by the branding box. So I'm actually considering just totally turning off the branding box entirely. But yeah, so more YouTube half-assery.
Are you finished?
I'm finished. I'm sorry.
You know how when I talk about things like cricket and plane crashes and things, and you're just like, I couldn't care less.
Right.
Yeah, that.
This is definitely one of these things where it matters to me more because I'm doing animations, but for 99% of people on YouTube, it doesn't make any difference. Like, what corner is being used by the screen doesn't matter because it's almost always someone's face in the center of the screen. So this is just my problem, which is why I'm complaining about it.
I do a lot of animations too, but I just don't think about that. I just like, maybe I should think about it, but anyway.
You're doing fine without thinking about it.
Well, you're doing pretty well too, though, so maybe I should think about it.
I don't think this is the difference that makes a difference.
We'll see. Anyway, there you go. If you really care about this, email Gray. So you've said something here about Europe and skyscrapers. What's going down here?
That's not me.
Is that me?
That's you.
That is me.
You're always trying to tell me that I put these things in the document and they're your things. This is not me. I didn't put it there.
I don't know. Just...
I swear, you don't know anything that you do. You don't know when you touch the microphone. You don't know when you add stuff to the document. It's like you're not in your own mind.
It often does feel that way.
Yeah, you're just on autopilot, just do whatever, looking at Twitter, checking your email, adding stuff to the documents and not remembering any of it. That's the impression I get right now.
It looks like there is plans for the tallest skyscraper in Europe to be built at a spa resort in the Swiss Alps.
Oh, really?
It would tower over London's Shard, which measures a mere 1,000 feet, yet Grace still wants to buy an apartment in it.
I do.
We'll put a link in the show notes if you want to
read it.
How
can this article have no picture? God damn it. Articles are so useless.
Yeah, you'd think they'd be like artist's impression or something. But
no, they just have some picture of a little town and then like a stock photo of a woman in a spa. Stupid article. I want a photograph.
When I was the reporter for the city council in Adelaide and new plans would go in for a building and I could go and get them from the council offices, like they put in all their planning submissions. Man, that was exciting. I knew I had a good story that day when you'd go in and they'd say, yep, we've got some plans.
Oh boy.
Oh yeah. That's page five. That's page five, page seven, maybe. Depends how good it looks. I think I maybe even got a page one a couple of times with them.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Artist impressions of buildings. That's money in the bank for a council reporter.
Exciting.
Big deal. Monday morning when the council agenda came out for the meeting that week with all the reports, oh, that was a bonanza. That was a treasure chest of stories.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Sounds very exciting.
Happy times. It's really fun being a newspaper journalist. I really miss it.
Oh yeah? Why don't you go back? I'm sure they'd take you.
Yeah. Maybe.
No, so you don't really miss it enough to actually do it again.
Well, no, I have, just because I have fond memories of something. Do you know, I actually have a recurring nightmare that I'm back working at the newspaper? And it wasn't a nightmare to work there. Don't get me wrong. I loved working there. It was some of the happiest days of my life. Uh-huh. But for some reason, it's an anxiety dream that I've gone back now. I've like left England and I've gone back to Australia and I'm back in the newsroom. And I'm thinking, oh my goodness, what a terrible mistake. Why have I done this? Things were going really well. Why have I come back? It's like a real anxiety dream of mine.
Yeah.
It's probably my most frequent anxiety dream. And I can't emphasize enough how much I'd like the place. It's not like it's a nightmare place I don't want to go back to. But in the dream, it's terrible. It's like, oh, crazy. Things were going well. I was making my YouTube videos and things were good. Why did I stop? Why did I come back? This is a mistake.
Tell me more about your dreams, Brady.
Just as I said that, I remembered how much you hate dreams. I thought you might like this one, though, because it's like an anxiety dream and it's like a recurring thing. It's not like, you know, oh, one day I was walking down the street and my brother was Robin Williams or whatever it was you said. What you said. It wasn't that. It was like, you know, sorry, abort dream, abort dream conversation.
No, it's very interesting.
You're unhelpful enough with my attempts to start conversations at the best of times. You're being especially unhelpful now.
I try to be helpful. I'm just not very good at it. But the dream stuff is the absolute worst. There's nothing to grab onto. It's a conversational fog. There's no hope. There's no way out.
But you're really, really interested in psychology, right? And there must be links between dreams and psychology.
I'm not really interested in psychology, no, not really.
You're not?
No.
Okay.
I think it's mostly nonsense.
Well, while we're speaking of...
Sorry, my uncle who's a psychologist. I hope you're not listening.
While we're speaking of Adelaide and buildings, can I just quickly follow up on our previous discussion about the Black Stump building.
Please do. The mighty Black Stump.
The mighty Black Stump. The Grenfell Centre on Grenfell Street. A mere stone's throw from the Adelaide Advertiser building.
Oh, wow.
We had 3 people send in photos as requested, and they were holding a copy of the Advertiser to prove that they were contemporaneous pictures.
That was impressive.
Massive, massive kudos to those people. I've got a special blog page dedicated to them.
I like the guy who had it on the laptop. I thought that was the best.
That was a classy move.
That's the way I would have done it.
Yeah. I actually prefer the paper ones, but
of course.
But today we had a 4th contributor swoop down and steal the glory from those 3 contributors. And this was a guy called, I will look up his name because he definitely gets a name check. In fact, they all deserve a name check. The photographers were Guestyman. This is Twitter names, obviously, at Guestyman, at DG567828, catchy name. And Tablet Laptop Man was at Callum Gare. But the prize and the trophy goes to at Luke Avery 3, mm-hmm. who made a video with some podcast playing over the top of it, but we will forgive the freebooting because it was done so well, and I think it would qualify as fair use. He freebooted some audio, but did it brilliantly and made a video of himself walking into the lobby of the Grenfell Centre of the Black Stump while mm-hmm. listening to our podcast. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty special. My wife thought the video was very creepy. That was mm-hmm. the word she used. Looking back at it a second or third time, it is a bit creepy, but I still think it's brilliant.
It was impressive to see.
Yeah. Gray will link to it, maybe.
I will.
So in a not so recent podcast, we discussed the pronunciation of Saint Bernard,
right.
Saint Bernard.
Saint Bernard.
Yeah, or Saint Bernard as my wife would say in correcting me. So we had a listener from Switzerland, a native German speaker, send us in an audio file of his pronunciation. I don't know why he sent it now. He must have just listened to the podcast and felt compelled to have us hear how he thinks it should be pronounced, sort of the native way. Mm-hmm. And seeing it's an audio file, I will now let Gray do time travel magic and play it to you. Here it is.
Sankt Bernardiner.
So there you go. You just heard it. And Gray and I haven't just heard it, so we probably have not much to say. But I just thought it was really cool to have an audio file and follow-up.
So you wanted audio feedback, follow-up?
Yeah, I think that's something different. But don't send me your audio files to get them in the podcast. That will not happen. And I will not listen to audio files that get sent in now because I know exactly what you're all going to do. So don't even bother. I will delete anything with an audio file without listening. All right? That's just going to happen. I'm not even going to open it.
You're setting a real hard line in the sand there. What if it's a really valuable audio file though, Brady?
That line is firm.
What if it's an amazing email in audio form?
Then it's just been deleted.
Think about what you could be missing out on.
Don't care?
Not even it's if, gone. You know, someone it's solved gone. The Riemann hypothesis.
In audio form.
Right. You don't want to listen to that? No?
The audio book, the audio proof. Nope. That's going in the bin.
This seems unusually harsh for you. You usually have this fear of missing out on maybe something great in one of those emails. Just going to delete the audio ones.
I have a fear of missing out. You're the guy who doesn't want to go to Mount Everest, but will consider doing it if his friends are going in case he misses out.
I say that the value proposition there is just very different.
Can I do follow-up from another old podcast? This is not quite so long ago.
Sure, you can do follow-up on whatever you want.
This was only a couple of podcasts ago, and I just wanted to mention it because I felt like I should have last time. Mm-hmm. When I admitted that I had never consumed coffee, uh-huh. and you were like, oh, it's amazing, and I expected all the world to be treating me like a freak, I feel like I became a lightning rod and a standard bearer for all these non-coffee drinkers who've been in the closet for way too long. Uh-huh. And they all came out on Twitter and emails and that saying, thank you, Brady, for saying what we've all been thinking, that coffee is disgusting and it should not be consumed. And all these people saying, oh, I've never drunk it, I've never had it. I actually think Dirk from Verstablium even contacted me and said that he was anti-coffee.
Dirk from Veritasium.
Yeah. You don't have to correct me every time I say it incorrectly.
I don't always, because sometimes you move by it so quickly, it's impossible for me to try to correct it.
I think people know now what's going on.
Oh, yeah. You think so? Okay.
Yeah. So anyway, can I just say, fellow non-coffee drinkers, I'm with you. I feel it. I felt the love. Thank you for the love. And right back at you.
You're a real hero, Brady. It was really brave of you to come
It was big of me. It was big of me. And I feel like I've become a role model for a lot of young non-coffee drinkers out there. Someone they can aspire to and think, I too could be as old as Brady one day and had not drunk coffee. So stick with it, people. Stick with it.
Yeah. If you're going to have dreams, dream big.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm here for you.
Meanwhile, I used to tell my students, you need a cup of coffee. And they would all be like, oh, I heard it's bad for young kids. And go, no, it's fine. It's fine. This is Starbucks right around the corner. I'll look the other way.
We are once again really pleased to be sponsored by Hover. Visit hover.com if you're in the market to register a domain name. They have them all from .com names right through to exotic ones like .guru or .engineering or maybe .church if you're in the business of setting up your own religion, for example. But in all seriousness, Hover is really easy to use, no nonsense, a professional service, snap up all the names you need. They have great management tools, customer service, and a free valet service if you want to move your other domains to the superior Hover system. Everything simple to use, you can probably figure it out yourself, but they also have a brilliant customer support team if you want to give them a call. Or if you're like Gray and don't really go so much for the human interaction, you can use email for customer service, and they've got really good online tutorials. If you're feeling greedy and want to snap up a whole bunch of domain names, they also have volume discounts, so fill your boots. Now, as a Hello Internet listener, you'll get 10% off your first purchase if you use the checkout code CGPO. That's right, CGPO. So go to hover.com, that's H-O-V-E-R, hover.com, in case you're struggling with my pronunciation, and check them out. And when you do buy some domain names, make sure you use CGPO to get that 10% off. Our thanks to Hover for supporting Hello Internet. Speaking of, people being in touch with us, I think it is time for me to draw another line in the sand.
Oh.
And this is the emailing me to get to Gray.
Mm-hmm.
This is not going to happen. This is not going to work. And I'm now putting in a firm policy of no matter what it is or how important it is, it won't go to Gray.
Mm-hmm.
Because if I let one through, then I have to let them, then I have to let more through. So that's it. If you write something saying, I think Gray would find this interesting, or can you please show this to Gray? Not going to happen. And don't even try and be sneaky and say, and start your email off with, Dear Brady, I think you're really nice. I enjoy your videos. I was just thinking the other day, CGP Gray would really like to blah, 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 blah. That's not going to work either. I see straight through that. So.
It sounds like you've been getting a lot of my email.
I have. I'm now getting journalists email me asking for interview requests with you.
Mm-hmm.
That is like not going to happen.
We talked about this before. I think that is like over the professional line. But you go ahead and just delete all of those. I have an email filter that I think it uses the phrase "I am a reporter from" and just automatically deletes all those anyway. So never feel guilty. Never feel guilty about that.
Do you know what? I don't think that's over the professional line. I think if a journalist wants to contact someone, I actually think that's quite industrious of them to think, okay, I haven't got this guy's phone number. I can't seem to email him. Who else will know him? How can I get to him? I respect them for trying, like I would do the same thing if I really wanted to contact someone. I have done the same thing, so don't feel bad, journalist. You weren't being unprofessional, but you did it wrong. You didn't flatter me enough.
Is that what your problem is?
You probably needed to massage me a little bit. You probably need to say, I listened to your podcast with Gray and I think you're both awesome and I've got a specific thing for Gray. But there was none of that. It was no massaging. It was just straight to the, I hear you know him. Can you help me out?
Uh-huh.
No.
Podcaster problems. But I think that's kind of over the line. I have been weirdly on both sides of this, because there have been people who have contacted me trying to get in touch with other people that they know I know. And I always find that just, I think it's just weird. It's kind of, it's over a sort of social line. Like, wait, you, I don't know you, but you want to use me as the in to another person? Like, why would I ever do that for you, person that I don't know? This just seems wrong. This seems very wrong.
Well, the only way, the place where it fell down for the journalist is I think journalists are used to dealing with people who are impressed by journalists and who are impressed by the prospect of publicity.
Yeah.
And you and I, not to humble brag, but you and I, for various reasons, are past that point. So dropping an email saying, hey, I'm a journalist and I want to speak to your friend, you know, isn't this an amazing opportunity that's fallen in your lap? Like, that doesn't work. But I could imagine for other people that would work. It would be like, oh, wow, you want to talk to my friend? Oh, you're going to put them in the paper? Oh, that's really cool. Yeah, sure, I'll help you, of course, because I want my friend to be in the paper because we all think that's really cool. But
it's always just really expected. Like, I'm going to just jump at this opportunity no matter how inconvenient it is or how totally unhelpful it is to me. I don't know.
That's because they don't realize it's happened to you 100 times already.
But surely they do this for a living, right?
But 99 out of 100 of the people they do it to, this is their one moment they're going to be in the newspaper for some reason, and like this is huge for them, and they're like, yeah, like, so usually, but of course journalists are also used to being ignored and slapped in the face, and you're a face slapper or an ignorer, and they just move on. They didn't know you were going to be one of those. And they just rolled the dice. They're not sitting there agonizing about it. They've got about 100 of those emails out every day.
Yeah, I guess that's what it is about. So I don't feel bad deleting their emails, because it just doesn't work. I don't know. Anyway, yeah. Sorry, reporters. I don't need your emails.
I got a good email today from a famous newspaper website that is known for its freebooting, but they're savvying up a little bit. And I got this email from this woman saying, I've written a story about your video. That's a whole other story, but maybe we'll come to that another day. I've written a story about your video, but our newspaper has a policy of not embedding videos
from
YouTube. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can we put it on our player? Here's the story I've written. So I clicked through to the story to have a look because I was curious, and they'd embedded the YouTube video in it. So obviously they can embed YouTube videos and do, but they just try it on to see if you'll, you know, say, oh, okay, you can put it in your player yourself. I was unimpressed.
Yeah, this is why. Like, I have yet to have, I mean, aside from you, Brady, I have yet to have in the course of my professional career anything resembling a positive interaction with a reporter in any way, shape, or form. It's always just boundary pushing, or like they clearly already know exactly what they want to write and they're just going to try to manipulate you into a quote, or oh, we want to use your stuff to make money for us and then pretend like you're going to get any benefit from it, but of course you won't. It's just, you know, thumbs down. That's what I got to say.
Email, at least it's all email these days. I remember when I was court reporting on the newspaper, I wrote a story one day about a guy that had done some pretty dodgy stuff, and like, so I wrote the I'd been sitting in court and I wrote the story, and then I went back to the court building the next day for work, and the wife of this guy obviously knew who I was because I'd been sitting in court with a notepad, and she'd waited there in the morning for me, and then she came running up to me and giving me this torrent of abuse, tried to spit in my face, and then like all the security guards from the court had to come and surround me, and then like I got in the lift to go up to my office and they all had to get in with me, and she got in the lift as well and just abused me in the lift all the way up. And to get out of the lift, and then the security guards just had to take her away eventually.
Why was she abusing you?
Well, because I had written the story in the newspaper that had, you know, said bad things about her husband.
Ah, okay.
But like, I just reported what was said in court by the lawyers,
right?
And the guy had beaten up like a granny. And like,
That sounds bad.
I did kind of provoke her a little bit as well.
Oh, did you?
Well, she okay. She came up to me. Like I was a bit stunned. I wasn't like being arsy, but I was a bit stunned. And she came up to me and said, "I can't believe you wrote that stuff. Did you know that he's got, you know, a kid? And did you know that he does this? And do you know that he cleans up his neighbor's window every day and that sort of stuff?" Like right, saying right. What a good guy he was. And then I just said, "Did you know that he beat up an 80-year-old woman?" And that didn't calm her down.
No, that didn't throw some cool water on the situation.
No, it didn't.
And you knew it wouldn't either.
I don't know. I wasn't doing it to be defiant. I promise you, I wasn't feeling emboldened and confident. I was a pretty young reporter and pretty intimidated. But that was one of those times where the line just came into my head, and I said it.
Yeah, so it just happened. Nothing you could do about it.
Now, speaking of being recognised, I humble bragged a little bit last episode about some public recognition problems.
Mm-hmm.
And following on from that, you said at the time that had never happened to you.
Right.
And lo and behold, a couple of days later, I got a very interesting text from you. What happened?
It was not 12 hours after we put out the last podcast that I was recognised, not at an official event, for the first time ever. And I was recognized by my voice. And the very first thing the person said to me was, "You're CGP Grey," which was the funniest thing. The guy had not heard the podcast yet. He almost apologized. "Oh, I haven't listened to the latest podcast." I'm like, "Yeah, dude, it just came out last night." And, you know, it'd be very unlikely that you had listened to it. But I just thought after our previous conversation that was very funny that the very first time I was recognized in person, it was with the words, "You're CGP Grey."
What happened? Where were you? Like, what did this person hear you saying? And like, talk me through it.
I was recognized for the first time in the Covent Garden Apple Store of all places in the world. And I was actually buying some stuff for Hello Internet, and I was in there, and I was trying to use their little app where you can just buy stuff in store without having to talk to someone, which is my preferred way of shopping. But where I was, I couldn't get an internet connection to work. And so I thought, "Oh, I have to talk to the person." And so I just grabbed this guy and, you know, said, "Oh, can you bring up these items?" And I asked him if he had a bag for things. And he did the thing that I mentioned last time I see people do sometimes when I talk to them, which is they kind of look away when I'm talking. There's like this particular, "I'm trying to place this voice" look. And I saw it in the guy, and this was the first time he was able to place it. He went, "Boom, you're CGP Grey." And then so we just had a little chat for a little while. We talked about podcasts.
So it was the guy serving you?
Yeah, he was checking out the stuff that I was buying.
Well, could he not just have seen your name on like your credit card or something?
He was reaching under the table for the bags that they have, so I hadn't actually handed him my card yet.
Wow.
But anyway, so that was the first time I was recognized.
Did you enjoy it? I found it really uncomfortable.
Okay, so this happened to work out very well for both of us, right? Because there's two humans in this situation. And as I've mentioned many times, like, I am not very social when I'm just living my normal life. However, this happened to be one of these days where I was busy going from meeting to meeting to meeting, and this was in between two other meetings. So I had already spun up the part of my brain, which is, "Oh, I guess I have to deal with people all day long." And so I was kind of more prepared than I would normally be under these circumstances. And plus, I was already, I'm talking to a person because I have requested something from him. And so like I could not have been more receptive to this. So it went okay. But mostly I was just so startled that I'm not entirely sure really what happened. We just chatted for a little while, like I said. But
did he ask for like an autograph or a Grey fee or anything like that?
No. I would feel really weird if people asked for selfies. I think that's... I'm kind of with the Louis C.K. opinion on this one, that it's a weird, not normal human interaction when people ask for selfies. I'll link to this Louis C.K. video. I don't know if you've seen it or not.
It's the new autograph, isn't it? Like selfies, though. It's like, it's just replaced autographs.
Yeah, but I think autograph thing is weird too. I don't.
If you think, you know, yeah, fair enough. If you think they're weird, then fair enough.
I mean, this is just like, I'm just the worst person to have any kind of internet fame at all, because I was like, I really like my job, but I do kind of look at fame as a real downside of the job. It's just weird, and it puts me in a lot of weird situations. So this happened to be totally fine, but yeah, I think it was partly fine because he didn't say, oh, can I get your autograph? Or, oh, hey, meet the other people in the store. Or, oh, hey, can I take a picture with you? It was as normal of an interaction as it could possibly be between two humans. So I think that's also partly why it went well. So it was a very good meeting to be my first meeting in public.
He treated you gently for your first time.
Yes, he did. He did treat me gently.
Sounds like a good one. All right.
It's funny. I guess I'm a little sensitive to this sometimes because even when I was a teacher, being a teacher is kind of like being a very, very small scale celebrity. And something that would happen to me when I was teaching is if I was just out with my wife sometimes, students would see us and just like yell from across the street, you know, Mr. Gray, and they'd come running over and you'd have just this bizarre interaction. And I think teachers in a way who live near where their students are have a tiny view into what real celebrity life is like for super famous people of like, you're just walking along and you can't have a normal day out. People are just going to yell at you from across the street and come running up and then be really weird and awkward. That's partly why I'm more sensitive to this than most of the people I know, because I feel like I've had a tiny taste of it in my previous job.
Can I bring up a quick serious thing?
Yeah.
Just on the subject of teachers, because it just happened today and I wanted to bring it up for just because it was on my mind. I had a teacher a long time ago. He was my year 7 school teacher. And he's the teacher, I think, in many ways that was most memorable to me. And it was about a month or two ago, actually. I decided to Google him and find out, you know, oh, whatever happened to him? What's he up to these days? This is not the teacher that I made a video about on Periodic Videos, by the way. This is a different teacher. Mm-hmm. It's my year 7 teacher. Anyway, today I went on Facebook and I found out that he just died. He just very, well, I don't know, in the last few days, I guess. And someone posted it. I saw his picture in my Facebook feed, and it was the first time I've seen him since year 7. Someone had written, Mr. McCarthy, that was his name, has died, and wrote a little tribute to him. And then all the other students that have had him all wrote tributes to him. And I want to say, rest in peace, Mr. McCarthy, who was a really memorable teacher. He was really memorable for a different reason, though. He was the strictest disciplinarian you could ever imagine. He was notorious for it, and in fact he was a little bit violent, and I don't think you would get away with doing what he did in many circumstances because of how strict he was. Mm-hmm. But he really instilled a real amazing discipline in his students, and he just taught and ran a class like no other teacher in that whole school, to the point where when people found out about him, there was politicking and lobbying to try and get your kid into Mr. McCarthy's year 7 class, other than the other year 7 classes, because it would really change your life. And it really changed my life having him as a teacher. Not least of which, I'm a very accomplished juggler because of Mr. McCarthy. Anyone who was taught by Mr. McCarthy is a very skillful juggler. And that was also in the comments on Facebook. It would always end with, and he taught me to juggle. He taught everyone to juggle. He thought it was an important skill. And there you go. Mr. McCarthy, he just died. Teachers make a mark, you know.
Some teachers make their mark.
Yeah.
Not all teachers. I mean, how many teachers have you had?
I don't know, but do you know what? I could probably name them all. I can't name, there's a lot of people I've met in my life, but I could probably name most of my teachers.
I think you can name the ones that you can remember, so you feel like you can name them all.
Fair enough.
We're not actually going to do this, but you're way overestimating how many teachers you actually remember versus how many teachers you've had.
Do you feel like you're one of those teachers? Are there going to be kids out there in 20 years that are talking about Mr. Gray?
I don't know. I feel like that's not for me to judge. You know.
Sorry. Yeah, that was an awkward question. I'm sorry. You can't answer that. But what do you reckon?
I mean, I can.
Do you want that? Do you want to be that? Like, is that what teachers aspire to be? Do you want, like, do teachers aspire to be spoken about in 20 years, like I'm talking about Mr. McCarthy or Mr. Donaisky?
I mean, I think that's the kind of thing that keeps you going in a difficult job, is people like to think that. I was never aiming for that in my teaching career. My opinion on this is, it is just good to expose kids to lots of different kinds of adults, right? So you mentioned your Mr. McCarthy. He was a very strict disciplinarian, right? And lots of schools have someone who's a strict disciplinarian. Lots of schools have teachers who are really laid back, teachers who are really into their subject, teachers who aren't. I think it's good for kids just to interact with a whole bunch of different adults, because kids just will click with one kind or another. And that's something I was kind of aware of as a teacher, that you can see how, and after a couple of years, particularly in a school when you know a bunch of kids, like I was aware that there were kids who kind of reacted very well to my style of teaching who didn't react well to other teachers, and vice versa. So I think it's almost like it's not dependent on the teacher. It's dependent on the particular interaction between the kind of kid and the kind of teacher. I mean, this is, you know, we've talked about this before. This is like, I would not like to lie to my students. So I would tell them things like, oh, you're never going to need any of this ever again, which some kids would find horrifying and react very badly to, but certain kinds of kids would react exceedingly well to that. So it just,
do you think that would have been your, was that your like USP? Was that what Mr. Gray is, the guy that, you know, tells it like it is, or tells the truth, or treats us like adults? Like do the teachers know what they are? Like, you talked about disciplinarians and softies.
Oh yeah, the teachers totally know who they are.
So which are you? What were you?
My feeling was very much like, we're all in this prison together, and we there's things we all have to do, and let's just get through this together. So I never hid from the kids like my delight in snow days. I never hid from them like, oh, when things go wrong with the school, sometimes like with assemblies and things, like, oh, it's kind of delightful. So that's kind of the teacher that I was. And I tried not to build stuff up that wasn't actually important. And I know that worked with some kids, because more than a few times there were. I don't know how to put this, but there was a certain kind of kid who, when they were thinking about universities and future jobs, they would come talk to me because they wanted some advice about the working world from a teacher who wasn't just going to say like, oh, do what you love. Because, I made it pretty clear that I thought that was just terribly dumb advice.
Did being their buddy undermine your authority?
No. I want to be really clear here. I was not a buddy, and I kept it a very clear distance, but it doesn't hurt at all to be able to say like, I don't want to be here and you don't want to be here, but we're all still here. But that doesn't mean that like we're friends. Nothing spells death for teachers, and I hate to say it as well, for parents, than like wanting to be buddies and friends with a kid. It is just absolute death. Teachers that really want to be liked by the kids. I was always pretty indifferent in many ways to the kids. Like, I wanted them to do well. I didn't wish them ill, but I wasn't friends with the kids. I mean, the kids never believed me, but I would always tell them, they'd be like, oh, you'll remember us forever at the end of the year. The kids were always pushing this, like, you'll remember us forever. Aren't we a really special group? And I would always say, no, I probably won't remember you very well in a couple years. And they go, oh, no, it's not true. You'll remember us. And it's like, well, actually, no, it's years later, and I don't remember the vast majority of my students. Like, that's just the way it is.
I remember when I went back and saw Mr. Donaisky, who was my year 11, 12 physics chemistry teacher, and we made a video with him for periodic videos. I went back with the professor, and we went to my old classroom and spoke to him. And one of the things that did strike me was how little he remembered of me. Like, the professor, I think, asked him some leading questions like, oh, you taught Brady and now he makes these chemistry videos. What was he like as a student? And I thought he'd descend into the mists of time and pull out all these crazy anecdotes of things I used to do and little mannerisms I had that he used to like, or funny things. All he remembered was that I was a kid that broke an arm on a camp that he was on.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what he remembered about me.
Yeah, that's exactly
it. And he was friends with my mum. My mum was a teacher at the school. I thought that would at least give me a helping hand, but he really did not seem to remember much about me. And I thought, like, you know, I thought we had this friendship forged in blood that couldn't be broken.
Sort of like fame, it's this weird asymmetric relationship where kids have far fewer teachers than teachers have students that they're looking out for. And I should tally it up, how many kids I actually taught over my career, but you know, it's hundreds of kids. And if I sat down now and tried to write the names of kids that I had taught, I'm not sure I could hit 10 kids like that I would remember by name, you know, and like actually put a face to them and remember something more than just their name. But it was funny that kids always expected that they would be immortalized forever in my memory. And honest to God, like after a summer, I would forget some of the kids, you know, I'd teach the same class in like year 9 and they'd come back in year 10 and I'd have to bring out my old flashcards with their face and their name, you know, to get ready for the year coming out. Like, oh God, who is this? Okay. Flip through. Right. This person, you know, I don't know who these people are.
Yeah. Well, it's a good thing I broke my arm on that camp because that's how I got burned into his memory. He said, it's the only broken bone I've ever had on that camp that I run. And it was Brady. But, you know, I was like the head boy of the school. I was like, you know, and he was in charge of discipline. So, like, I thought, you know, all these things. And it's like, you know.
No, doesn't matter. I used to tell parents at Parents Evening, which, by the way, I always really liked Parents Evening. It was kind of fun talking to the parents. But particularly whatever the first Parents Evening was, it would be like 6 weeks into the year. It was absurdly soon. And it was just impossible to actually know who the kids were. But my standard line to the parents was always like, look, if I don't know you, who your kid is at this meeting right now, and I'm just referring to the book, that's a good thing, right? Because the only kids I know who they are right away are the kids who are trouble, right? The kids who are, like, are such a problem that I can remember them immediately after just 3 or 4 classes. Like, if I know your kid's name today, we're not having a happy conversation. So the fact that, you know, I don't know who little Susie is except for these numbers on a spreadsheet, that's nothing but good news. And I have to say, parents are always really receptive to that. This is, like, I found if you were just really upfront with people, like, I don't know who your kid is, I just have a bunch of boxes with numbers, and like you can understand that, right? I never had a bad reaction to that. People get it. Hello, Internet. This episode is brought to you by Lynda.com, the online learning platform with over 3,000 on-demand video courses to help you strengthen your business, technology, and creative skills. Now, Lynda always wants us to talk about all of the various courses that they have, but there's something else on my mind with Lynda right now that I want to tell you about, because I am recording this just mere hours before I am going to be on an airplane flight. And one of the things on my travel checklist is to make sure that everything is downloaded and synchronized on my iPad. And one of those things is Lynda.com's app. They have an app for the iPad which allows you to download any course you want onto the iPad to have it available offline. And I love this feature. One of the times I find it best to go through courses is when I know that I'm going to have a big chunk of uninterrupted time, and that is on an airplane. So I have a course downloaded right now that's related to one of my many secret projects that I will probably be going through on my long flight, and having the offline access is just amazing. So Lynda has just tons of courses related to maybe your secret projects. They have things about income tax fundamentals. They have things about running a paperless office, which sounds great. You can learn about typography or color or online services like If This Then That, which is a very cool automation service. Just about anything you could possibly imagine, they have a course on it. With a Lynda.com membership, you can watch and learn from top experts who are passionate about teaching, stream thousands of video courses on demand, and learn at your own schedule and your own pace. And courses have transcripts that you can follow along with and sample materials that you can download. It really is a complete course. Now, if you go to lynda.com/hellointernet, you will get a free 10-day trial that gives you unlimited access to all of the courses on Lynda. There's nothing to lose. If there's something you want to learn about and you think, oh, let me see if they have it, just sign up and check it out. And you can just take the whole course if you can consume it in 10 days. So whether you are looking to become an industry expert or you are passionate about a hobby or just want to learn something new, go visit lynda.com/hellointernet and sign up for your 10-day free trial to give Lynda a try and to let them know that you came from our podcast. That's lynda.com/hellointernet.
Speaking of recognition, which we were talking about before we went off on a couple of tangents there, you've been wanting to talk about recognition for a few episodes now. There were a few things on your mind. What was that all about?
I think I have been living where I currently live, and I have had a settled enough schedule now that within the past several weeks, all of a sudden, all of the people at my regular places, pubs, restaurants, cafes, I am recognized now as a regular. They don't know me as CGP Grey, but it's the, I can walk in and the girl's like, oh, hi, let me get you what you normally get. And it has all happened everywhere all of a sudden. And
that's nice though, isn't it? Isn't that a nice thing?
I can't go to any of these places anymore now. That's
crazy, Gray. That's what community is about. This is what a community is. People long for that. People now say, whatever happened to the good old days where people knew each other by face and name and knew what each other liked? And you're lucky you are getting a taste of that in a big city like London, and you're turning your back on it.
Oh, luckily there are many Starbucks by me, but I have already burned through a couple of them where they recognize me as the person. I figure as soon as I walk in there and they know what drink I want before I order it, I have to go somewhere else now. I can't go here anymore. And I have to wait until it's long enough that they've forgotten who I am, or there's a change of staff.
Why for goodness? Surely Mr. Efficiency would see the efficiency of this and say, well, this is brilliant.
No, because look, I'm from, all I can think of, for example, is delis in New York. If you go to order a deli sandwich in New York, even if you go to the same place every day, the guy behind the counter will barely acknowledge who you are, even if he sees you all the time, because they are great about actually moving the line. Like, we've got to keep making these egg bagels all morning, buddy. You know, we don't have time to chat about anything, and they just keep moving you through. So there can be a little bit of efficiency. Like, oh, right, yeah. Two eggs and bacon cheese on a roll, sesame roll, great, boom, done. You know, move down there, pay for it, pick it up. What I find is like in several of the cafes or in the pubs, as soon as they know you as the regular, they want to have like a little chat now. And so they go, oh, how is your day doing? And that is like, oh God, please, let's not do this.
That's what you're running away from, social interaction.
Let's not have a pretend conversation about how my day is, and then I ask you how your day is, and we have to, like, can't we just stand here in silence while, you know, you run my credit card or I order the food or something? Isn't that much better where we both kind of, like, look away from each other and sort of pretend like we're not there?
Well, that's not a good attitude, Gray. So basically you're thinking, oh, this is good. I'll just go through 50,000 credit card transactions and then I'll die not having spoken to anyone or shared the joy of my time on earth with other human beings.
If I'm getting a sandwich, I just want to get the sandwich and I just want to sit down. I don't want to have, here's the thing. It's never going to be a real social interaction between you and the other person. So it has to be this like horribly painful pretend social interaction. And
that's how it starts, but maybe over 5 or 6 years it would develop into something else.
No, it can't possibly. No, it's not going to happen. So I have to change places when I get recognized.
Well, I walk the dogs at the park, at the garden every morning, and I think it's wonderful as you get to know people and they get to know your dogs and, oh, look, oh, it's Audrey, how's she doing? Oh, I saw her a week ago and she was playing with a black dog and like you have little chats and you walk along next to each other for a few meters and you comment on the weather or the car parking or the trees. And I love it.
That is also an entirely different scenario, because you're walking the dog. You're kind of explicitly on a break to interact with people. I could see walking a dog through a park and talking to people and meeting with the dog. Okay. That's fine. That's kind of different, but it's the pretend social interaction at a kind of commercial exchange. I want to get my drink and give you money for it and then get on with whatever I'm doing is just as fast as humanly possible. That's what I'm there for.
I used to go to this bar in Nottingham, and at the time my drink was gin and tonic. Mm-hmm. And I used to go there quite a lot, and they always put like a lime in your gin and tonic. And for some reason I don't like that. I like it being put in there just to give it a bit of lime maybe, but they would always make my gin and tonic, and then I would just take out the lime between my finger and my thumb and just leave it on the bar and then just like walk off and have my drink. Mm-hmm. And that happened so much. They got to know that. So they just stopped making my gin and tonic with a lime, which I thought was, you know, good. And I'll never forget one day I was there at the bar and it was packed and there were you know, hundreds of people ordering drinks, and I ordered a gin and tonic, and there was a new woman working behind the bar, and she made my gin and tonic, and she put a lime in it, and one of the other bartenders leaned across to her and said, "He doesn't have limes in his gin and tonics." And I actually really liked that. Like, it was like, it's like ultimate customer service. Like, you know, this is awesome. You know, they even know how I like my drink. And if one of the others does it wrong, it's like self-correcting as well. Like, I quite liked it. And yes, it did mean I went there too often, but I liked it.
If I could just get the benefits without the downsides, I would be on board with this as well. If I didn't have to actually order, if I could just boop, you know, pay for it and they'd have the thing, that'd be great, because I am a creature of habit, so I do stuff the same all the time. But yeah, whenever I'm recognized, it's like, oh, I can't come here for a while anymore, and I'm running out of places. This is the problem.
I think that's really sad, and I think you shouldn't feel that way. But
let me tell you a story that you will feel the saddest about then.
Okay.
A while back at what used to be my closest Starbucks, I happened to be online. I was going to get coffee as I normally do, and the dude ahead of me online was one of these people who, there's a very good saying in life, which is, if everybody around you is an asshole, you're actually the asshole, right? Where it's like, if absolutely everybody else seems to be causing you problems, you're the problem. And this guy was just, you could just tell right away, he's one of these people who's just a jerk. But he thinks everybody else is a jerk. And so he got into a disagreement with the guy behind the counter at the Starbucks over some nonsense, like the credit card transaction or whatever it was. I can't quite remember the details anymore. But it was one of these cases where the dude was clearly in the wrong, and the Starbucks guy was doing everything he could to possibly placate this person. But the guy ended up being like, okay, I know, I happen to work at this big company, and give me your name, and I know the managers at Starbucks, I'm going to contact them and tell them how terrible you are, and blah, blah, blah. So he kicked up this big fuss. And after he left, I told the Starbucks guy, oh, hey, why don't you give me your name as well? Give me an email address so I can write to them and say, look, I was online, I saw this altercation, and this guy was totally just a jerk, and the manager handled it very well, which was the case. I took his email, I took his name and his email address, and I wrote it in. And it actually was like a thing. Like, Starbucks wrote back and said, oh, thanks, yes, we had a report from this other person. Apparently, like, something actually happened. And then from that point on, this guy in Starbucks was the nicest guy in the world to me. Every time I went in, he would make sure that everybody else put my drink right to the front of the line. Like, and it, all I like, oh God, I don't want this special treatment. I don't want this special treatment. Please don't do this. And he was just super, super friendly. And I eventually figured out what days he works. He works there on Fridays and on the weekends. And as far as I know, I haven't been back to that Starbucks in, I think, about 2.5 years now on a Friday or a weekend. I pass by it all the time. I still see him in there, but I always feel like, nope, if it's Friday or the weekend, I'm going to the further one. I can't do it. So the bottom line of this is that no good deed goes unpunished, I think, is the moral of the story.
Professor Mike Merrifield, who you know and have met a few times.
Yes,
who's in a bunch, he's in some of my videos. He was telling me a story. He has his local garage, he goes, where he gets fuel or gas for our American friends. And he was in there one time paying for his petrol, and the place got held up. A guy came in with a gun.
Oh, yeah.
Held up the place, you know, robbed, you know, police came, all that sort of stuff. No one was hurt, but the guy behind the counter got held up, and Mike was in store at the time. He was like the innocent bystander witness. And Mike was saying he still goes back to that garage all the time and buys fuel. And every time that guy serves him and they see each other, there's kind of this sort of weirdness between them. That I'm the guy that was standing in the corner the time you got held up with the gun. Like, and there's a real awkward dynamic between them that won't go away. And they're kind of, it's always going to be there because they went through this thing together.
Right,
and they don't know each other forever. Or anything. You know, they don't know each other. They were just the two guys in the room when the gunman came in.
I could never go back.
Yeah. I think that's follow-up all done.
Oh, good, good.
In just on the hour.
Oh, perfect. I think I might cut down some of the stuff in the beginning, but...
Yeah, I think maybe.
Yeah.
I hope so.
Yeah, I think it took us a little long to get actually started.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you're listening to this podcast and it's been going for an hour, Gray has not done his job editing.
Yeah, I think we have a good 10 minutes at least to probably cut out of the beginning of us going, oh, let's talk about thing in a really boring way.
Yeah.
So let's see. We'll see how it goes. Oh, I'm sorry. That time I hit the microphone.
I hope you keep that in.
I'll keep that in. I'll keep that in.
Let's move on. Now, I didn't want to mention this, but if I don't mention it, people will ask about it.
Mm-hmm.
Playing Crash Corner. I know you don't like it, Plane Crash Corner.
Is this like, I just saw on Twitter people were saying there's like some horrible plane crash. You don't need to talk about it.
This is what I think people need to realize. Like, I don't really know what the point of Plane Crash Corner is. I don't really understand why it exists and how it started.
You're the only one who's doing it.
Yeah, I know.
You're the one loading coal into this engine and going, yeah, I don't know about this.
But there has been
pushing this but you.
I just want to bring up Plane Crash Corner to let people know we're not going to do Plane Crash Corner today. We don't have to talk about every horrible plane crash that happens.
Yeah, thank God.
Yeah. So we're not going to.
Okay. Great.
By the way, I also will hold up my hands now and acknowledge what a tremendous mistake it was of me to ask everyone who wasn't on a plane to send us a tweet to say that they weren't on a plane.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, you thought it was like a funny joke at the time. I didn't.
I didn't think people would take it so seriously. I thought people would listen and have a chuckle and think, imagine if people did that, wouldn't it be funny? And like get on with their life. I didn't think they would then take out their device and write the tweet.
Yeah. I mean,
but they did.
Like, I don't want to be overly dramatic here, but you basically made my Twitter unusable for a day and a half. I've just so many at replies of just like, oh God. If I was going to be on Twitter more, I would have had to set up an actual filter, to try to like clear all of this stuff. But you can't have a podcast with as many listeners as we have now and ask them all, like every single one of them, to tweet at you. But you know what?
Since when do they do everything I say? Okay, can I just say to all the people out there listening, can you also please subscribe to my Numberphile YouTube channel and periodic videos and 60 symbols and sign up to my Patreon and the Hello Internet Patreon and donate vast sums of money to us?
Yeah, but that's...
They're not all going to go and do that now, are they?
Yeah, because sending a tweet is funny and it takes 2 seconds. Of course they're going to do it.
Well, it was a mistake. I'm sorry, Greg. Yeah,
but you know what? You're going to have to live with this mistake for forever, because just like we got the St. Bernard feedback from episode 4 or whatever, right? People who listen chronologically for the rest of time are going to tweet at us when they get to that point and go, oh, I'm not on a plane right now. And it's 5 years in the future or 100 years in the future. And we're dead and we're still getting tweets from people about how they're not on airplanes. That's what you've done.
Or maybe like airplanes won't exist anymore and people will be like, well, of course I'm not on an airplane. Yeah. They haven't existed since the year 2040.
Yeah. This will never end now. So actually,
can't you go back and you can go back and edit the podcast retrospectively though, can't you? Can't you just cut that bit out? You can't rewrite history.
That particular podcast, for various reasons, was an editing disaster that I don't even want to talk about. So it would actually be relatively difficult for me to cut that out, but I might have to at some point.
If it's any consolation, it was worse for me because you did
say... I don't care. It's not any consolation. The fact that it was worse for you doesn't make me feel any better. You got what you deserved is what that is. I wish it was 100 times worse for you.
Are you being mean to me, Gray? Because you know what? You know your mum told you to be nice to me.
She did. She told me that I should be nicer to Brady.
No, she didn't. She said that you were good because you were nice to me in the last podcast.
Yes, that was the feedback from my mom, was that she likes it when I'm nice to you and she doesn't like it when I'm not nice to you.
Well, let's be nice to Brady then. Let's say something nice. Come on.
I like doing the podcast with you, Brady.
All right. That's what I wanted to hear.
Even if you cause me trouble on Twitter.
I do cause you a lot of problems.
You do. You do.
I'm like that. If it's any consolation, I'm like that with everyone in my life.
So yeah, I somehow didn't think this was unique to me. I didn't feel like, oh, this is just for me. This is special.
You got to take the rough with the smooth.
Yeah, I guess so.
Well, seeing we're not going to do Plane Crash Corner, uh-huh. How about we do iPhone Corner with CGP Grey?
Oh, see, now this is a corner I can get excited for.
Go on then. You know how everyone loves it when we talk about Apple products. especially all those Android users, because it's especially useful for them because they know less about Apple products. So it's like more informative for them.
Yes.
They're the ones who like it most, I imagine.
It is extra happy for Android users. Oh man. Yeah. I've gotten so much, just as a slight side note here, I've gotten so much angry Android email from people. Because in my last video, I mentioned, or 2 videos ago, I mentioned that I was putting the video up on iTunes and RSS, but it was like iTunes was some kind of trigger word where they couldn't possibly hear the fact that RSS existed for them as well. And I was just flooded with emails from angry people about how they can't believe that I'm supporting Apple and why won't I put it on the Google Store? And it's like, oh, dude. Half the video was about how it's on RSS as well. I made a special point about art, but I swear it's like people's brains just turned off as soon as they heard, you know, iTunes. It was just
maybe
done.
Maybe basically you said, "Hey, CGP Grey, talking really really fast here. And did you know that my videos are going to be on iTunes?" And they pressed pause, wrote the email, and then unpaused, and then you said, "And RSS," and they were like, "Oh."
Well, I didn't get a one apology email if that was the case, but. that'll teach me if I'm ever going to mention something that is on Apple and something else, I'm going to reverse it and say it's on something else and Apple, right? Like that's the way I'm going to have to do it if I don't want to get just so many angry people. But anyway, that's a side point here. So okay. for all those people, we're going to talk about our iPhones now.
All right. Go on then. Okay. They'll be happy to hear me talk about it because you know how I feel about my iPhone.
Yes. So... We have revisited this topic many times because you and I have both been frustrated with our iPhone 6s since they came out, I think is fair to say.
Yeah.
I presume that you still feel resentful, I think was the last word you used to describe your feelings towards your iPhone. Was that the case?
Yeah. I kind of feel about the iPhone the way you do about that guy in Starbucks. I'd prefer to avoid it when I can now.
Perfect. Perfect yeah. Time back. Yeah. So here's the situation with me. Here's why I'm bringing this up. Mm-hmm. I kept dealing with my wife's iPhone 5. And as I mentioned, every time I picked it up, I thought it was like a little happy sound from heaven descended upon me when I picked up her iPhone 5. And I was like, oh, this is just the right size. I can use it in my hand. And I've tried everything. I like the D brand case. That's the best. I tried using it without a case. I've tried absolutely everything. But I kept just finding myself, like you, just not liking the phone. Just how it's the wrong size. And I kept picking up my wife's old iPhone and thinking, this size is really good. And so I thought, I have to make a change here.
You did not.
I can't live like this anymore.
Tell me. You didn't, did you?
What do you think I did?
Have you gone down to a 5S?
I actually went up to a 6 Plus.
Idiot.
Did you just call me an idiot?
Yeah. 6 Plus?
Okay, so listen. Hold on. I kept picking up my wife's old phone and really liking it.
Do you realize that's smaller than your phone, right?
Would you let me finish here?
Go on.
But so I also, every single time I walked by an Apple store, I would look at the 6 Plus. And every time I would look at the 6 Plus, I thought, this phone is just ridiculous. It's like a boat. It's so huge, it doesn't make any sense. But I kept being aware of the fact that I kept looking at the 6 Plus. And I've been doing this ever since it came out, right? For months now, since September. And, so my frustrations just kept growing with the regular 6. And I was coming to a point where I thought, I'm going to have to do something about this because I just don't like this phone. But I was afraid about Apple just never making a smaller phone again. Like, okay, well, I don't want to do that, like step backwards in technology. And then, well, Apple's left anyway on their rocket spaceship to the future, and they're not dealing with smaller phones. So what are you going to do? Use a 5 until the end of time? No, you're not. So while all of this was going on, I was just trying to think about, well, what to do. A friend of mine, Mike Hurley, who runs the excellent Relay podcast network here in London, Mike has been pushing the 6 Plus from the very start and trying to get everybody on the 6 Plus train. And I've been listening to him talk about this on podcasts for a while, and I've been listening to him talk about it in person when we've met up a couple of times. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to give it a try. There's a 14-day return policy. I'm going to take Mike's advice. I'm going to buy the 6 Plus and just try using it for a little while to see how it is. And I'm here to say that Mike was right, and I love my 6 Plus. I am totally on board with this phone in just the way that you should be with an Apple product. I have no ambivalence about it whatsoever, and I should have gotten the 6 Plus right from the start. So,
what about, I guess you don't talk on your phone a lot though. What about when you hold it up to your face and it's like pressing a dinner plate up against your ear?
I almost never talk on the phone.
Well, if you never talk on it as a phone, I start to see the sense in it, because then it's just becoming a small iPad.
Okay.
But if you want to use it as a phone, or if you're an action man who's hard as nails and, you know, gets out and about and does things, you've got this huge, massive rectangle in your pocket while you're crawling around under cars and climbing mountains and things.
Right, right.
It's okay if it's just you sitting in Starbucks who uses it like an iPad anyway. But I think for people who want to use a phone as a phone, I'm not buying it. But anyway, keep talking.
No, but it's interesting, because I actually use my phone almost entirely in transit, because I have an iPad with me lots of times when I'm working or if I'm going out for the day. So it's not like I'm sitting down. Like, if I'm going to work, I'll take out the actual iPad. And if I'm at home, I'll use my computer or an iPad. So I still use my phone very much the way I used to use my old one, which is in between locations. But what I find is, you have hit on the exact point, which I think makes it very, very palatable, which is the iPhone 6, my brain thought, like, this is just, it's just the wrong size. It's just a little too big to type kind of comfortably. I can't quite use things one-handed. It's all frustrating. But my brain treats the 6 Plus as like, oh, this is a micro iPad.
Yeah.
And I feel like since my brain has entirely different expectations, all of the frustrations of the phone are gone, because some part of my brain just keeps thinking, oh, this isn't a phone. This is an iPad Micro. Of course you wouldn't try to use it in the same one-handed reach the screen everywhere way that you would with a phone, because it's not a phone. It's a tiny iPad. And it sounds silly, but that has completely changed my experience. And that's why I love it.
I can imagine that, because it's like the 6 hasn't quite decided what it wants to be.
Yeah.
And that causes me problems, because I think I said to you another time, when I'm using it, it's like I have cognitive problems using it. Like, I used to be really quick at using my old 5, and I'd press this and do that and move this. And when I use this one, it's like I'm like, what am I doing? What am I pressing? And it's like I'm drunk every time I use it.
Yes.
And I think it's just because I can't. You know, it's not because I've changed. It's just that it makes me dumb.
I had a similar experience, which is the typing is frustrating, or doing other things are frustrating. And so the big change with the 6 Plus is that I use it two-handed way more, because it's just bigger. But the experience is much better, because when I'm holding, like, I can take out, I actually can use the 6 Plus one-handed just, but the vast majority of the time, there's something on the screen, and you're holding the phone, and your brain just says, well, you can't possibly hit that button in the top corner. This is what your other hand is for, right? And so your brain brings your other hand around, and you press the button, and it's a satisfactory experience. Whereas on the iPhone 6, everything is just reachable, but in a clumsy way, or, you know, you have to try to manipulate one-handed to do it in a very awkward way. So the experience is terrible every time, but you can just do stuff. I use the iPhone Plus two-handed, walking around all the time, and I absolutely love it. So I have to say, if there's anybody out there who was like incredibly frustrated with their iPhone 6, the 6 Plus, that is the way of the future. Try it. Just, this is my recommendation, is put away your old phone and just use the iPhone 6 exclusively for a while. And you will get used to it so quickly.
The 6 Plus, yeah.
Sorry. The 6 Plus is what I mean. Yeah. You will get used to the 6 Plus so quickly if you put away your iPhone 6 and don't use it for a little while. And just last week, as I think I've had the phone for about 3 weeks or a month now. And just a week ago, I picked up my wife's phone that I hadn't happened to touch for a while. And that was the moment I knew that I had made the right decision, because I picked up my wife's phone and I thought, I could never use something this small again.
Mm.
And it was no more ambivalence. It was like, no, I'm on the right path with my Apple decision. And the other thing I like about this is that I'm now on the same page with the kind of decisions that Apple makes, where Apple likes stuff every year to make it thinner and lighter, which I always found frustrating with the phones because I thought, I want more battery. But the iPhone 6 Plus does have more battery. And now my primary concern is, yes, Apple, let's make this phone a little smaller, a little thinner, and a little lighter. And I'm happy to keep the battery life the same because it is noticeably longer with the battery. So I'm very, very happy. I happen to have a really intense day with the phone because I had a kind of overnight trip that I had to do. And so I was just incredibly active on the phone one particular day. And I was amazed that I made it through the entire day without having to charge it. And my old iPhone would have never made it. I would have been stranded halfway through trying to find an Apple store to buy a charger. But the 6 Plus had enough battery to last me through a whole bunch of Ubers and video and photos and email and a bunch of stuff. So I absolutely love it.
How come you've had an iPhone 6 Plus for a month and haven't told me?
Has it ever been relevant to any of our conversations? Has it ever come up?
No, because you didn't tell me.
I was also partly just trying it out, but I feel like you always want a lot of information from me, Brady. Do you want to know all of my new purchases?
No, not all of them.
Do you want to know what I bought at the Apple store that time?
Yeah.
I bought a tripod and a little attachable lens for the phone.
Ah.
Is that exciting to you? Is that interesting?
Yeah. What are you going to film?
Well, what I'm actually going to try to film is stuff for Hello Internet. I filmed a couple things since we're so far behind on the YouTube version. I thought, oh, I can try this little tripod and a nice lens to see if I can get a couple of like time-lapse city shots to use to upload for the YouTube channel.
But I thought we were doing like office toys and things. You're thinking of moving away from all those little desk toys and that on the YouTube channel.
All I know is that the videos come from you very slowly. So I thought I'd take things into my own hands.
Well, you never ask me. You've only got to ask.
Okay. Is this going to be high on your priority list right now? I'm not even sure that it should be.
Well, it can't now because I'm about to go away, but...
Okay.
All right.
So what other purchases of mine would you like to know? What have I bought recently that Brady should know about?
I think an iPhone 6 Plus counts as one you should tell me about, considering I'm like a guy you talk about iPhones with all the time.
We're talking about it right now.
All right. I hope you're not keeping secrets just so we can talk about them on the podcast.
I'm not keeping secrets just so we can talk about them on the podcast. Do you know who I also didn't tell? My wife. She didn't notice that I had a new phone for, I think it was 10 days before she finally spotted it. She came home and I actually had both phones in front of me because I was transferring stuff from one to the other. And she happened to not notice. And then I thought, oh, I wonder how long it will take her to not notice. And the answer was about 10 days.
And what did she then say?
Oh, she was just really interested, and she was also shocked. She couldn't believe that I bought it. But yeah, she was like, you bought a new phone and you didn't tell me? I thought, well, you didn't notice it first. And now it was just interesting to see how long this was going to take.
I had a funny incident a couple of nights ago with my wife where I couldn't wait. I must tell you about it. And it made me, because I just know how disapproving you would have been and how it was finally something my wife and I do have in common when it comes to technology. Mm-hmm. She was sitting on the sofa trying to do something. And she had an app open on her iPad. And I think she like had another app, maybe a calculator or something on her phone.
Mm-hmm.
And she was like trying to hold them both at the same time and like transferring information between the two, like reading it off one and typing it into the other and then mm-hmm. typing back in. And I was like, why don't you just go and get your your laptop. She's got like a MacBook Air. Why don't you just go and get that? You know, you realize you can have two applications open at the same time on that, mm-hmm. rather than this weird scenario where she was just holding two screens in either hand. And she was like, oh, I would, except it's like full. And every time I open it, a message comes up saying it's full.
Oh, the hard drive thing? Yes.
Yeah. So like instead of like dealing with that, she's just stopped using that altogether. And now mm-hmm. she's just using her like her phone and iPad as the, you know, as her mm-hmm. two windows that she can mm-hmm. move between. And I thought that's Miguel. That's something I would do.
Yeah, that sounds exactly like something you would do.
Yeah. So I was like, yeah. Anyway.
Are you gonna get a 6 Plus? That's all I want to know. What do you think?
Well, no, because
does
I can't
it sound
imagine...
convincing to you?
It does sound convincing. The only thing I remain unconvinced by, though, is like wearing a nice pair of fashionable trousers and a shirt out at a bar and having this whopping great rectangle, like a miniature football field, sticking out of my trousers. You know,
it fits in my pocket. Just, it's in my jeans and it just fits in my jeans. And I am aware that if it moves to the front of the leg, that I've developed this habit of kind of pushing it to the side unconsciously before I sit down, if it's right on the front of my leg, because then it is a little too big. But I if you try it, I really think you will see that it is not as big as you think it is once you use it for a little bit.
Yeah, I just think I use my phone differently to you as well, though. Like, I want to be able to just hold it in one hand and quickly just peck something indiscreetly.
I thought I was this guy as well. In a one-handed usage was hugely important to me, and it turns out that I can get by just fine.
Okay, but your phone's modifying your behavior, so like shouldn't the phone suit the behavior we want? Like, should the phone change us?
Yeah, but I have made small sacrifices in one-handed use, which turns out to be not as important as I thought it was, for huge advantages in all other regions. So it seems like it's a great trade-off to me. This is, you know, like we've said in the podcast before, you want to pick something to amplify. And if you want one-handed use, you have to buy a 5 or the 4-inch phone, like the iPhone 5 style. If you want one-handed use, that is the phone that you should buy. And if you're willing to let that go, the 6 Plus gives you huge advantages. But I am more and more convinced that the 6 is the phone for nobody. It's the in-between phone that has all of the disadvantages of both. And that's why we have both found it so frustrating over the past several months. I also love the horizontal mode. I mean, I've always wanted to use my phone in horizontal. And so I use this one in horizontal just all the time, and the apps rotate. It is just the greatest. And I can do real work on this phone in a way that I wouldn't do on my other phone. I love it. I really recommend it. Mike was right.
I just want the technology just to go away a bit. Like,
you sound so grumpy over there, Brady. You sound so grumpy.
Yeah, I'm having a bit of a technology fatigue day, to be honest.
I think a nice 6 Plus would really fix that for you.
No, do you know what's going to fix it for me?
What?
A week on a beach in Australia.
Ah, yes. Your upcoming trip?
That's going to fix it.
Can't come soon enough, I guess.
Well, actually, it's coming a bit too quickly now. I can't get my work done, but that's another story.
Yes, this is the problem with being self-employed is, my vacation, I have to pay for that in advance. And I will pay for it still with interest even when I come back. Yes.
Yeah, that's what my wife always says. She says, going away for a week for you is all well and good, but it's not just going away for a week. It's then 2 or 3 weeks of pain afterwards.
Yes. So you and I have both been preparing for trips at the end of this month. And I have had this trip coming up for me on my got to get ready for list for 6 weeks now, you know, to have everything set up in advance. And it is just being self-employed has many, many advantages, but carefree vacations is definitely not one of them. Definitely not one of them.
Well, this episode has also been sponsored by our really good friends, Audible.com. What can I say about them? They are the go-to place for audiobooks and other spoken word material. Now, if you're listening to a podcast, and, well, I'm imagining you are, I don't have to sell you on the benefits of being able to listen to smart stuff or, well, in our case, maybe occasionally a bit of dumb stuff. We all spend so much time in cars, on trains, planes, and maybe doing other things like working out at the gym. Well, yeah, I probably should be doing that, but I'm not really. Anyway, these potentially tedious times can become really enjoyable with Audible. I know now these days I get really excited when I have a long day of driving ahead because it means I can do some hardcore listening with no distractions. Well, hopefully no distractions. I am paying attention to the road, of course. Now, Audible selection is huge. You already know this. If you go to audible.com/hellointernet and sign on to the service, you can download one of their audiobooks for free. I'm going to recommend one by an acquaintance of mine. It's called The Mathematics of Love, and it's by Hannah Fry. Hannah's an occasional Numberphile contributor, and her book has been published in conjunction with the people at TED. She gave a TED talk, and it was so good they snapped her up and said, come on, we're also going to do a book. The book's really good. It's all about the genuine mathematics that underlies our love lives, everything from dating to even the mathematics of bickering with your partner. And best of all, Hannah reads the book herself, which is great. She's a real character. She's got a really good voice. And it's really good hearing her read her own words. I really recommend it. So there you go. There's a possible free book for you to download if that's what you want. The Mathematics of Love. But don't worry, Audible has plenty of others. Go and have a search on the site. Knock yourself out. So go to audible.com/hellointernet. Then they'll know you came from here. And check them out. And our thanks to Audible for once again supporting the show. I feel like we should talk about the solar eclipse that just happened. But I haven't got that much to say about it, and I can't imagine you're going to be much help.
You already know what I have to say about this.
Where were you for it?
I happened to actually be online at the US Embassy waiting to get into the world's unfriendliest building to do some fun tax paperwork. When the eclipse happened, and I wouldn't have even known if it wasn't for like, oh yeah, is there an eclipse going on now? And then checking the time on my phone and saying, oh, it's happening right now, and looking up at the sky, which in London was completely clouded over, and trying to convince myself that, oh, I guess it was a bit dimmer. So that was my experience with the eclipse. Would have never known it was happening.
It did feel cooler. Like for those listening, pretty much where Gray and I both were. It wasn't a total eclipse, so it was in the sort of 80s to 90% of the sun covered. You had to go further north to get totality, but I got a good look at it, and I got out the eclipse goggles and my camera and everything, and I enjoyed it.
The best part of the eclipse for me was the adorable photograph of Audrey that you sent me with her wearing her eclipse glasses. That was the whole eclipse. The alignment of the sun and the moon was worth it for that adorable doggy photo.
I have to say, I think eclipses are brilliant. I went and saw one in China a few years back, and it remains one of my best work memories. Like,
oh yes,
and like, yeah, they are an extraordinary thing to see if you get a good look at one properly. And it's nothing like on TV or videos or pictures. If you ever get a chance to experience one, and our American friends will get a chance to experience one in 2 years, a really good one, don't miss out. Don't miss out. They're amazing. And they're just special things, aren't they? They're like, do you not get a bit caught up by the romance of them?
I can definitely get behind an eclipse. I think it's the mathematics of it is interesting. I think we happen to have this lucky ratio in sizes between our sun and our moon, just by coincidence. So like, I can appreciate that, but the actual reality of standing in London on a cloudy day, waiting on a bureaucratic line and looking up at the sky and wondering if it's a bit darker, that experience was less than awe-inspiring.
Yeah, that's not the fairy tale, is it?
No, it's not.
Anyway, America, 2017.
Where is the best place?
It pretty much rips through the whole country, right through the guts. So you can
take it. Can't be that wide, though.
Well, it's not that wide. No, you've got to get on the line.
That's why I'm asking. Where's the line?
Well, hang on. Let me call it up. There are also places where it lasts longer than other places.
Yeah. America, as you may have learned, is very big. We even have different weather in different locations in our country.
I told you about that last podcast. Don't pretend that you were the one who figured that out.
That's true. I did not figure that out. I needed you to tell me.
Are you on, what should I send this?
A 3,000-mile-long country has different weather.
I'll send you on iMessage the path that the 2017 eclipse takes. But it's kind of around.
Think we'll still be doing the podcast in 2017? Can we have eclipse follow up in that time? I wonder if we'll still be doing it.
I don't know. Do you think it'll still be going in 2017?
I don't know either. Let's see. South Carolina, Tennessee, Missouri, right across Nebraska. this is going across some pretty unpopulated areas. Nebraska, yeah. That section of Wyoming, man, that is an empty section of Wyoming that the eclipse is going across.
You kind of need to choose where to go based on sort of weather as well, though. I think it's more over to the west, where the weather forecast is probably better.
So it looks like the residents of Charleston, South Carolina, are probably the luckiest residents of a big place. In between Eugene and Portland, but neither of those cities actually itself.
It'll be worth a look. I expect I will be over there for that.
Mighty Lincoln, Nebraska. Yeah.
I reckon you will be too. I'm going to put a bet on now that you will be in America for the 2017 eclipse.
Why? For the eclipse, or I will just happen to be in America at the time?
I think you will have a trip to coincide with the eclipse, mainly because I think between now and then something will probably be organized that you'll get on board with.
Do you know something that I don't know? It sounds like you have plans.
I don't know. Actually, I'm having a meeting this week to discuss possible plans, but I don't have any specific plans. But
yeah. Are you sure Destin hasn't arranged some kind of crazy moving follow the eclipse event?
Destin's probably on the moon for it, but no, I know he has plans. He has plans with a mate of his already. We spoke about it the other day. He's got plans with a mate, but
of course he does. Of course he's planned ahead for this.
Yeah. So anyway, there you go. 2017. Can't wait.
Yeah, maybe we'll have follow-up then.
Yep.
Remind us, internet, if we forget.
Yeah. So, another thing that has been going on that lots of people have been asking about is this new video service called Vessel.
Yes.
Henry of Minute Physics, Minute Earth, and Deke of Vitabium,
Derek of Veritasium,
have both announced that they on it. They're going to be involved, and you can get first look at their videos through this new subscription service. And it's this kind of possible rival alternative to YouTube, and there's lots of excitement. You know more about it than me, like with most things. Do you want to explain to people what's going on and whether they should be excited or interested? I guess you have to be pretty positive about it, don't you? Because two of our best mates are using it. But
I did ask today on Twitter if there were things that people wanted us to talk about. And I partly wanted to gauge if there was actual interest in Vessel. And everybody wanted to know about Vessel. So mm-hmm. I feel we have some kind of obligation to talk about it. And full disclosure, I guess, it's not under NDA or anything, but some people at Vessel did reach out to me a while ago, and we had some talks about possibly being on the platform, which obviously I'm not on there now, so I decided not to do it. But so, yes, I have talked to some people at Vessel. Just, I don't know if I'm never quite sure we need to disclose stuff, but I'll just mention that at the start of this conversation. Mm-hmm. So I have to say, when I first heard about Vessel, I thought, boy, this is an interesting idea, and this has the possibility to be a real YouTube competitor in ways that lots of other things that I have seen do not have that potential. So the basic business model is that creators on Vessel, so like Minute Physics, they will release their videos on there for some amount of time exclusively. So 3 days, 5 days, or 7 days, that will, when Minute Physics releases a new video, you will have to watch it on Vessel if you want to watch it within, I think Henry's doing 3 days, if you want to watch it within that first period. After that window of time is up, then the video can get posted anywhere else. And Vessel is going to be a subscription service for its members who want to get access to new stuff immediately. So right. that's the business model. Did I explain that clearly?
Yeah. So it's like a YouTube alternative, but you pay. But the thing you're paying for is to get to see it before anyone else who doesn't pay.
Yeah, or the comparison that I've seen most, or actually you might not know this, but it's like Hulu, which in the States is a similar service for regular TV shows where they have a paid service where you can get access to shows early. And if you are willing to wait a little while, then you can see shows for free with advertising elsewhere. Although I should say that Vessel does have advertising even with its membership service, just as Hulu has advertising with its membership service as well. Although I think it is less. I'm not 100% sure about that.
Okay.
But.
So that's the thing. What do you think the pros and cons are here? What do you think it's going to be a raging success? Do you think it'll be a slow burn?
So it's really interesting. It's really interesting. And this kind of gets into the economics and the business of how this works. But Vessel doesn't need to be as popular as YouTube to be successful, because it is a business where it is directly collecting money from customers. Hmm. And as we have mentioned, people just underestimate that on YouTube, like the volume that YouTube deals with in terms of views to generate money. If you want to make a living just on the YouTube advertising, you need an enormous number of views to have like a normal middle class life.
Hmm.
But if you have a business where people are directly paying for something, you need orders of magnitude fewer people in order for that to be a success. So Vessel could actually be way more profitable than YouTube with far, far fewer viewers, which is one of the reasons why I thought, like, boy, it's an interesting business model and it has a lot of potential to succeed. Maybe not succeed in the sense of it destroys YouTube, but be an entity that can exist separately from YouTube and also be very successful for the people who are using it and for the business itself. So that's one of the reasons why I think it is just so interesting and so different from a lot of the other YouTube competitor stuff that I've seen, most of which falls under the category of, we'll just try to be better than YouTube and grow bigger than YouTube. And like that's a tall order. To take on YouTube directly. Whereas I see like Vessel is almost taking on YouTube obliquely with their business model.
Yeah. You did bring up that you spoke to them, which, you know, seeing you brought it up, I'll ask you the obvious question. Why are you not doing it?
It's been very interesting just these couple of days because I've gotten a bunch of feedback from people who want to know why I'm not on Vessel or if I'm going to be on Vessel. And I'm not saying at this point I'll never be on Vessel or any kind of similar service. But for the moment, I'm choosing not to do that. And for me, it's partly because over the past several months, one of the things that I've been constantly alluding to is I have all these other projects that are going on or that I've been very busy. And for various reasons, I have wanted to make sure that my own business is kind of secure and independent of other platforms. And so that's one of the reasons why I ultimately decided to go with the RSS syndication of my videos. So this was two of my videos ago. I told people that I'm going to make an RSS feed available that people can subscribe to. And just like the podcast, they can get my videos downloaded to their phone or their computer directly.
Hmm.
And this is a system that is directly under my control. I am paying to have these files hosted. I'm not signing up to a platform. It's not like, oh, I'm going to bank on Vimeo now, or I'm going to bank on some additional service. So even if something like Vessel was attractive to me, my primary concern is making sure that I have a business that can still operate independently of other platforms. And so that's why at this stage, I've kind of decided to double down on direct support from my fans through things like Patreon, and also direct interaction with people and being able to directly push videos to them. So that's through RSS and that's through email. So not having to rely on other platforms.
You're so cautious, Gray. I mean, and you're very smart, and I'm, you know, it's good that you're doing it. But sometimes I feel a bit like you're the guy who builds a bunker in his backyard because he's scared there's going to be a nuclear attack. Like,
no.
You know, you do seem like a worrier sometimes.
Again, you always use this word worry, and that is not how I feel at all. Let's put it this way. I think I am not cautious, but people who have been paying attention to YouTube have noticed that a decent number of creators in different fields have all recently been trying to diversify in various ways. And it's like there's a lot of people who aren't leaving YouTube, but they're making sure that they have like a foot halfway out the door with a solid platform to stand on. Like I'm not the only person in this category, and though there are things we can't talk about directly, that does kind of let you know that there are whispers on the wind that have some people worried about the way YouTube is going to be running their business. And we have talked about the stuff like the Zoe Keating thing from several episodes ago that has people worried. And I do think that is the biggest threat to Vessel, is if YouTube wants to play real hardball, and if they don't want to compete on a business level and instead want to compete like a bunch of jerks, they'll try to lock everybody down into these simultaneous release contracts, saying that if you release videos anywhere, it has to be everywhere all at once, which would make creators choose between Vessel and YouTube.
It would make Vessel's business model untenable because they're no longer offering a special thing.
Well, I still think, just like Hulu, they would still have videos that are behind a paywall for some limited amount of time and then viewable by anyone. So I think they would still have a viable business model if YouTube was forcing creators to choose between the two of them. This ultimately comes down to how fast can Vessel make more money for the creators on its platform than YouTube can make money for the creators on their platform. And given YouTube's abysmal ad rates, I would be reasonably confident that Vessel might be able to achieve that quite quickly if they're able to get enough people to sign up fast enough before YouTube brings down the hammer. Again, if they want to play, from my perspective, in a very unfair move of forcing people to choose, a very anti-competitive move. What are you thinking over there?
I don't know. Why do things have to change all the time?
Life is change, Brady.
Yeah.
Things are never not changing. There's nothing in stasis.
Yeah. I don't mind things changing, but I wouldn't mind like a bit of a stasis, like bedrock underneath.
It has felt for the past couple months like there have been particularly shifty sands underneath my feet, business-wise. I'm feeling better now having moved to having a mailing list, which I've encouraged you to do, and also now trying out RSS.
I have got an email list.
Yes.
Yeah.
So let me ask you, Brady. Does Vessel seem attractive to you? Is that something that you would consider?
I would need to know more about it. It doesn't appeal to me increasing my workflow and having to manage, double all my accounts again, and when you've got six or seven really active projects, doubling them doesn't really appeal to me. But it could potentially come to a point where every time I make a video, I then have to spend 3 days putting it on all these different platforms. Now I've got to put it on my iTunes and RSS, and I've got to put it on Vessel, and I've got to put it on YouTube, and I've got to do, and now I've got to tweet it and then Facebook it, and then I've got to go and put it on my blog, and then I've got to go and put it on Patreon, and then I've got to, and it just gets to a point where I feel like I'm spending more time on the back end than I am actually creating and making the films. I want to spend all my time creating and making, and I want slapping it on the internet just to be like an afterthought, like, there it is, now you guys enjoy it, I'm going to run off and make another one. But it feels like more and more of my time is just being sucked up by putting it online and promoting it and making, I don't want that.
You have my sympathies here. People often have requests about, why don't you just do this additional one step? And people just don't realize, like, man, all of these one additional steps add up and it becomes a huge list of things that you need to do one tiny step at a time. And so, yes, for anybody who's doing this for a living, considering an additional platform is a huge deal. Like, it's a lot of extra steps.
Oh, yeah. Oh, why don't you caption your 2,000 videos, Brady?
Yeah. Yeah, that kind of thing. Well, you know, why don't you go back and fix this? Or the one that I get as well is people go, oh, why don't you have a nicely organized list of citations and sources at the bottom of your video?
Mm.
And it's like, yeah, I could do this, but man, is that a lot of work for very, very little benefits on every single video of trying to keep track of sort. It's like, yeah, in theory, that doesn't sound like it's a lot, but it adds up. And it adds up with all of the other things. So today I did the RSS release for the first time, and it was relatively simple. It's actually a lot simpler than putting something up on YouTube. Mm. But I was aware of, like, oh God, this is an additional 10 things on my checklist that is already, you know, was 60 something items long and is now 70 something items long. And so I've had a bunch of people say, oh, why don't you also be on Vessel as well? And it's like, oh God, if I uploaded videos as often as you, it's a huge hassle. So there needs to be a lot of advantage to an additional platform that you're going to add. I do think Vessel does potentially bring that to the table if they can make the money work, which is why I think they're such an interesting business.
Yeah.
That's what has always caught my attention about them right from the start.
Well, people, go and check out Minute Physics, Minute Earth, and Veritasium on there, and tell us what you think, and we'll find out whether we should be doing it too. Those guys, Henry and Derek, are trailblazers.
I will still say that even if Vessel is successful, I still think it is unlikely that I would switch to, or I would do Vessel in addition to YouTube.
Hmm.
I can imagine some kind of future day where I have to choose between Vessel and YouTube, but I have a hard time imagining doing both.
My problem with Vessel at first glance is I haven't signed on yet, so I haven't really seen behind the curtain. But when you look at their like landing page, they seem very focused on, you know, celebrity and big popular stuff, and it seems like they want to be. It already feels like they want to be TV. You know, they don't want to be. They don't want to be what I like most about YouTube sometimes, which is, you know, anyone having a go and some new independent person striking it. It sounds like they want things that are already big, and they want everything to be big, and they want it to all be glossy, and, you know, they want it to be like, they want to be more like Netflix than YouTube.
I think that is explicitly part of their business, that this is curated. It's all so new. This has just happened in the past couple of days, the publicness of it. But I don't think just anybody can sign up and create a new channel. I'm not sure that's the case.
Yeah, I don't think so.
They got an impressive list of people to go over. And I mean, I have to say, if I was YouTube, I would be a little worried about this. I would be I'd be more than a little worried.
You always just say that YouTube's a music platform. So as long as Taylor Swift and all those people aren't
Vessel has a lot of music deals.
Right.
Right. And that is particularly interesting because YouTube is bringing down the hammer about you have to choose with our simultaneous release contract.
Hmm.
And so there are big music players that have said, we are going to choose Vessel. That's why I say, like, yes, I would be worried if I was YouTube.
Mm. You know what they say, Gray?
What?
May you live in interesting times.
That'll be the intro sound.